Hi there, happy new year everyone.
Happy welcome to the Grantham regulatory webinar, update webinar, our monthly review of the events and developments in the world of financial services regulation. As some of you know from having joined these before, we like to kind of categorize or put a theme around some of these just to give it some coherence. Today's theme is going to be double toil and trouble, fire burn and cauldron bubble, which for those of you that know the references from Shakespeare's from Macbeth. And the reason for that is partly because I've got an English GCSE lesson going on in the background. And partly because it potentially captures the situation we find ourselves in a national level. Hey, you would have thought actually a few days after Brexit, shops are closed, medical systems falling over, we've had to be locked up. You know, the Remainers were right all along. Maybe not, but it is a fairly dark old time. Thank you for joining us today. What we'll attempt to do today is to run through some of the key developments in regulation. I'd say this is a monthly webinar we've been performing. The last one was December the 2nd, so we'll kind of look with closest interest at what's happened since December the 2nd. For instance, Gavin has acquired some new glasses, you might have noticed. Apologies if I call him Harry Potter at any point. It's just a slip of the tongue. But we'll attempt to look at some of the major points coming out of the regulatory space over the last month. And also, as we normally do, we'll attempt to do a run-through of some of the, you know, potentially less headline-grabbing developments, but things that indicate what business as usual regulation looks like just at the moment. There are a few slides on your screen at the moment which just give you some instructions on how to use the system here, the GoToWebinar system. There's a process for submitting questions into the questions tab, and Gavin and I will attempt to address those as they come through. As people will know from attending these before, potentially we'll be kind of ramble around the place a little bit. But we will always endeavour to try and pick up your questions. So setting aside GCSE English for the moment, Gavin, state of the world. It's interesting times, and it's interesting times not just for the world, not just for the nation, but for the regulator as well. Because as we expected, a little bit before Christmas, the Gloucester report was published. And for those that don't immediately recognise that phrasing, that Gloucester, Dame Elizabeth Gloucester was appointed to do an inquiry into potential regulatory failings in respect of LCF, the mini bond scandal. And she produced her report before Christmas. I think, Gavin, you said before, you know, if you wanted a whitewashed report inquiry, you would not hire Dame Elizabeth Gloucester to give it to you, would you? She was fairly punchy in her criticisms.
Yeah, I mean, we talked back in the autumn, I think, about the rather acerbic exchange of letters between her and Charles Randall, the FCA chair, which I've certainly never seen before. And it's also worth remembering, I think, that she was the judge who was on top of the Roman Abramovich and Berezovsky trial in 2010. And it's worthwhile having a read of her summary judgment then. So she doesn't pull any punches, and neither does the report. There's a lot of stuff in there, and I think, well, there's a couple of things. One is, I think it will cut across to at least some extent the transformation programme. I think the FCA will try and integrate them as much as possible, but they will, I think, be different from each other. And putting things together in terms of words on a page is very different from actions and the actual decisions you make about the shape and direction of various kind of internal reform programs. So that's definitely worth watching. I think the other thing is probably that it points up a lot of the a lot of faults, a lot of flaws in the way the FCA runs. not, I mean, I think that those of us who know the organisation from one way or another over time won't be surprised by a lot of them. But I think the underlying thing is probably that the FCA could do a lot better, but actually things like LCF are almost inevitably going to happen in the future because you have 60,000 firms and the FCA, I don't think, will ever reasonably have the resources in order to analyse every one of those, or even the high risk ones, in the way that the report recommends.
Yes, I mean, I think my view of the report is, it's a great read. I mean, for those who haven't looked at it essentially identified failings that should be actioned in the views of Dame Gloucester. And we'll touch on what some of those key recommendations are in a second. But it also goes at some length to consider or give her a view of how the FCA and senior management and the FCA have handled the process of their investigation. Some of the responses that were they provided to presumably draft report wordings, etc. And it's fairly damning in that sense. So some of the headlines that relate to this sequencing of events some of the senior executives at the FCA have had to forego bonuses or deferred bonuses. But it's interesting to read Dame Gloucester criticise quite heavily the FCA's response to her concerns. It would be unreasonable to identify single executives who are accountable for particular failings, etc. And she obviously is quoted back at length the SMCR rules.
Yeah. No, I think that's perfectly reasonable, actually.
Yes.
The only thing I'd say is that the FCA's application of SMCR to itself is somewhat high level. And it doesn't really, if you look at the document and you look at how the FCA actually runs, it's a far more complex organization than you would think from looking at its SMCR responsibilities map.
No, I absolutely agree. Whenever there was ever an organization where singling out one individual or a small number of individuals as being responsible in isolation, and it's difficult, I would think it would be the FCA. But anyway, it was an interesting interchange. In terms of actual recommendations, I mean, the ones I picked out, there's things like things that might help, but there is no guarantee that they will help. To your point about 60,000 firms to regulate, do they? Yeah. Will you ever really make an LCF star situation go away? So the recommendations that the firms are assessed holistically, so there's a clear non-regulatory perimeter versus unregulated activity by the same firm thing, which I imagine will be something that we see playing through more explicitly, i.e. if you have regulated activities and unregulated activities, I think the FCA is probably going to feel compelled, if it's got the time and bandwidth to do it at least, to take a much closer look at your unregulated activities. The FCA needs to be better at escalating fraud allegations, which is investigating those, which is fine, except they can get a heck of a lot of them. There's no easy way necessarily of those. But one of the big ones, the biggest one from in many ways to my mind, is that all data and information on a firm should be in a single electronic system, which is using automated technology to generate red flags, which obviously does align with Nikhil Rathi's headline agenda items coming in, wasn't it, to rebuild or replatform the technology capability of the FCA. But I guess to your point earlier, even if you do these things, it's still a heck of a challenge to follow through every red flag, follow through every allegation on 60,000 firms. I know we've got the Treasury Select Committee all over this, aren't they? They've talked about this report before already. I think they've got another session coming up, haven't they?
And I think Dame Elizabeth Gloucester's going to the TSC on the 1st of February. And I think Andrew Bailey, who's the FCA's chief executive at the time, of course, is going a week later. I mean, just on those three areas, I mean, the perimeter has always been an issue. I don't think the FSA or the FCA has ever done enough about it. But it does take you into the territory of analysing and trying to do something about activities that are beyond where your powers sit.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, a lot of risk comes from there. A lot of risk to the system comes from just outside. Fraud, you're dead right. It's uncontroversial to say that, you know, suspicions of fraud and reports of fraud should be escalated. You still have to do a triage because you're not going to be able to look at all of them. So there's still going to be a huge element of prioritization. But yes, absolutely, I'm sure the FCA should be doing that stuff better. Data has been a perennial issue, frankly, ever since the FSA was formed, from its 12 or whatever it was predecessor organizations. They all brought their own systems together. There's never been enough sustained executive will or investment to replace those in a way that is up to date and sustainable. The best you get is when you have a major scope extension like consumer credit, which allowed them to bring in a major external platform because frankly they needed it for the doubling of firms that they had. So they had the investment capacity to do that, but it's very hard to kind of borrow and invest ahead of the curve as a regulator. I mean, it's genuinely a really hard thing to do, but it's a challenge. I think the other thing, just to finish off, is that there's an underlying sense in the transformation program that you could do more with less, that you could make the whole organization much more efficient. I'm always skeptical of that, but I think particularly reading the Gloucester Review, it's pretty hard to imagine a system that would be better at detecting future LCFs that's actually going to be cheaper than the one we have now.
Yes. So let's talk about what the FCA is doing then. So, Nikhil Rathi is now the CEO. He has already initiated a transformation program with the executive director responsible for that. And this idea that the step change in the systems capability, data capability of the FCA will flow from that is key there. And we recognised before that's going to be an incredibly hard thing to achieve. And then there's the whole subject about cost base and fee base for the FCA. Yeah. We'll touch on separately actually. But he's also, and I should say actually, he's accepted the recommendations of the Gloucester report and indicated how it aligns with how those recommendations align with his own strategy. So he has, as we referenced before, brought together supervision and authorizations, changed the responsibilities. We have an executive director appointed now for, so there's two executive directors for that combined division, isn't there? One essentially covering consumer sell retail activity and another covering wholesale, slightly more complicated like that, like most things in the FCA. But so one of those directors has been appointed is Sheldon Mills, who's Consumers and Competition, I think his title. So he's one of those two executive directors. So it's starting to fill out some of his executive team, although still quite early days, I think, would be my observation.
Yeah, it's quite hard to work out exactly where the respective lines between those two executive directors of supervision and the competition, where they're going to be. I mean, I almost get the sense that it's left slightly deliberately vague so that you have less well-defined silos than the FCA has had in the past, so that people are almost kind of obliged to work together more because actually the overlaps are acknowledged. If they can do that well, then great. But again, it doesn't exactly take you into SMCR territory. So I think it'd be really interesting to look at how that restructure pans out, because obviously you have, you can do some sector stuff, let's say, but then you automatically have things that run across. And building the bridges across the different sectors and subsectors and having a matrix that works and is relatively transparent, has always eluded senior management.
Yes, maybe this is you're right. An organisation has become too siloed, for instance. Do you flip the needle to an extreme degree in the opposite direction to try and change the culture? Maybe that's a little bit about what's going on here.
So one of the classic examples of this is the kind of 2004 restructuring, which was still in place when Northern Rock happened, where you had wholesale and retail, and Barclays quite reasonably was put in retail, but it also meant that Barclays Capital at the time was in retail and not in wholesale. So there was a whole kind of dislocation of you know, how did you look at Barclays Capital in the context of all the other investment banks discussed? And it was never really sorted. So fixing that sort of problem, which will always exist no matter what your structure, I think is one of the problems they face.
Well, I imagine we'll be talking about this on a fairly regular basis as we get more information around structure changes, yeah, etc. There's one action that the FCA is taking off the back of the LCF, the Dame Gloucester's report, which I wanted to throw up as a poll question, actually. So it's not one of the big three I mentioned, but I mean, it's one that potentially would affect firms. So people on this call, your firms could be affected by this in a more direct fashion than maybe some of the other changes. So one of the things they're going to do over the next 12 months is to do a use it or lose it review, which will basically look at permissions that firms have. Again, this is FCA specifically, firms have, and if they're not being actively used at the moment, to remove them. And so for poll question, some of you I hope will have been through this before, but if you people on this call have a view on whether they're sitting on unused permissions or not, it might be interesting just to see what people think the practical impact of this might be from a number of firms impacted. Okay. Well, there's a fair chunk of I'm not sure, which I'm not surprised about, actually. So that tells me there's actually a decent number of firms that might have to field questions about whether or not they need a permission that they've currently got. And I guess, you know, maybe it's no bad thing if an unused permission gets taken away. But I guess equally you wouldn't want that to happen, I think, without being conscious of it and being happy that it's the right thing for your business. So we'll see how that program works out. We don't have any details about exactly how it's going to be conducted. Just there's been a commitment that it will take place. So other structural things around the FCA, well, sort of semi-structural, is what might be happening to the FCA's fee base, people that pay fees to finance the FCA. And it's been moving parts. So one of the things that was published in the last week, actually, wasn't it? Was the FCA's analysis of how, in their view, 4,000 firms they authorised were under financial pressure. I mean, 30% of those might fail. It's been interesting to look at the detail of that. So two things. One, that's based on a survey of 20,000, I think, no, about 19,000 responses. So it's not all the firms, but it's just a sizable chunk. Yeah. But more probably that was surveys that were completed in June of 2020. So June.
I think some of them were February.
Absolutely. From that period, yeah. You are absolutely yes. The very late last one was by June.
Yes.
So the report doesn't attempt to extrapolate that out. It's basically saying at that point in time, 30% of these firms, 4,000 firms might fail. One would only assume, I think, and not unreasonably, that might be a bigger number now. It did provide some analysis around different sectors, etc. You know, here's a shocker: retail lending was the most impacted sector in terms of reduced revenue. Not surprisingly, since they have been very limited in terms of what they can do about collections and obviously great bad debt risk more generally. But the point I'm making is not what the number is now. You know, if let's assume it's more than that, that very likely will mean the FCA's fee base shrinks to some degree. Brexit will play out in terms of how many authorised firms you have and how much activity is contributing to fee to the fee calculation in the UK versus the EU, etc. So there's a lot of uncertainty, or at least reason to be concerned that the FCA's fee base is going to decline.
Yeah. So if you assume on a net basis, balance sheets will get smaller because of Brexit. I mean, clearly there's some firms that have subsidiarized who were branches before, were EU branches, so they'll attract more fees. There's a netting off here. But on the whole, let's assume it gets smaller. And then you've got the resilience stuff as a result of the pandemic, and you're going to assume some of those firms will become insolvent and go out of business, and others again will have reduced business and lower balance sheets and so on. So potentially you've got a smaller fee base, unless you charge the very big firms more, which has happened in the past. But it is an issue, I think, is the bottom line. And you know, so going back to what we were saying about the Gloucester review, inevitably there's going to be pressure on fees.
Yes.
What do you do with that? You know, you're being asked to do more. Yes, you'd be more efficient. Yes, you can digitize, but it will cost investment up front. But if you're more efficient, you digitize, you're probably going to find more problems earlier. And then you still got the choice about, well, am I going to act on all of them or only some of them? Yeah. And if the latter, then how do I decide? And what do I do about the ones I don't act on that then blow up?
Yeah.
So it's a difficult, you know, there are lots of difficult circles to square in there. But the resilience stuff's really interesting, actually, because I think the other thing is that it speaks to the fact that the FCA is now having to do a substantial amount of prudential regulation, which has never done before. And I know we've talked about this in the past, but that again is essentially an expanded, greatly expanded activity where you've drafted in people from supervision, policy, even from enforcement, to staff that work.
Well, one of the FCA's responses to the Gloucester report, I think how they phrased this, it was to recruit additional prudential specialists to work with firms, complex business models and support other teams. But yes, that's a pretty clear commitment to spend more money on a particular type of individual.
The FCA had a small and very good prudential team, but the emphasis was on small, because when the split came in 2013, almost all the prudential resource was given to the PRA on the basis that the FCA wouldn't prudentially supervise any organisation that was important.
Yeah.
Discussed. But that was the theology at the time. When Twin Peaks was created and there was, you know, FSMA 2012 and so on. So it shouldn't be a surprise to anyone that this is not an issue given the pandemic. I think the question is what you do about it longer term.
There were some macro responses. So you could reduce or at least control the cost of regulation if you limited business models, you know, were much more prescriptive. It's sort of a low innovation, homogenous population is easy to regulate. But if you want, as our politicians suggest, you know, highly innovative, forefront of creativity in the world of financial services, then that's not going to come cheap. The options are hit the big firms even harder. Fines. These days, all the fines go to HM Treasury, don't they? But I guess
mostly. I mean, I think historically they've traditionally gone back to the industry. Obviously, not the firms were fined, but all the other ones had fee book. And then when LIBOR and FX benchmarks came through as really quite massive fines, the Treasury started taking some of that money. Big chunks of it, in fact. So I think one of the ways you could fund the FCA more than you do at the moment, but it's controversial, is allow them to keep a higher proportion, or dare I say, all of their fines, But that then brings the whole accountability and perverse incentives argument into play. I think you have to look at all this stuff because it depends what sort of system you want.
Something's got to give. And I guess
more innovation is almost certainly going to be more complex to regulate.
And I guess if I was sitting in a large firm, I would be betting on fees going up for your firm and others in that peer group. Just as a personal view, that's the most likely line of least resistance potentially. Okay. Let's stop talking internal FCA things. Let's talk COVID. Oh yes.
Hooray.
Well, let's find something new and original to say about COVID. I don't know, there is nothing new and original to say about the regulatory response to COVID other than we're in a, I don't know, you used a phrase, I know, it's almost like there's nothing that the government might do, and by dint of that, the regulators in order to keep the plate spinning. So all that temporary stuff, the guidance that was issued in consumer credit and insurance, etc., is probably going to be rolled over. At what point do we start speculating that some of this temporary stuff is actually going to become permanent?
I think probably now. I think that if you look at the furlough schemes currently April. The FCA temporary regs on mortgages and consumer credit, I think, are April, but then I think you can put claims in, but then I think you can still claim July or something. So that's well over a year from when they were first introduced. As we've talked about many times, you've got more vulnerable consumers now, a lot more than you had at the beginning. And you've also got an economy. When we used to do that poll about do we have a V-shaped recovery? I mean, how ancient does that feel? So I think we've got this kind of bumpy W that kind of extends an indeterminate distance into the future. So you've got this kind of scarred economy with lower household incomes, mass unemployment, et cetera, et cetera. At what point is it realistic for the FCA to say, actually, these temporary measures are no longer needed? So I don't know where it lands, but I think there's a world where actually they, in some degree, they extend because you've got half the population. I mean, we've also talked about K-shaped recovery in the past, where a significant proportion of the population doesn't recover; it just gets poorer for the long term. So in a world of vulnerable consumers, I think it becomes really quite hard for the FCA to say that these temporary measures are no longer needed.
I know. And at some point, I guess you're just thinking about how this might play out from a Hamburg point of view. You don't necessarily need the temporary guidance because the whole concept of vulnerable customers potentially is the avenue through which on an individual basis, of course, but help is provided, assistance provided.
But obviously, firms are taking a hit from that. So there needs to be some kind of settlement that allows, that acknowledges the forbearance, if you like, that firms are being forced to show through the temporary regulations. They may have done some of it, a good chunk of it anyway. And how does that play out longer term? But it's not a case, I don't think, anymore of just, okay, we stopped the temporary measures at the end of April, whatever it is, and we're back to normal. I just don't see how that's tenable.
No, just as a quick thought experiment. Is the government kind of want to see record levels of repossessions, for instance, from homeowners in arrears on their mortgages?
I think that's the point where the PRA starts to worry. So at the moment, the PRA is quite, I think, it's fairly relaxed about, banks, capital and balance sheets and bad debts and so on, partly because the government has taken the hit on the kind of, supporting the lending ultimately. But if you get into a world of mass unemployment and falling property prices because the stamp duty holiday has ended and repossessions and so on and so forth, then I think that's that obviously gets more treacherous on the central side.
As we were observing the other day, you know, quantitative easing was introduced as a very short-term temporary measure back in the financial crisis, and now it's taken sort of the basic tenet of our financial operations as a country. So on vulnerability, here's a thought. We're talking about vulnerability in relation to consumers, but arguably around business interruption insurance is a bit of a case study on this. Should that concept of vulnerability potentially be extended to commercial customers, SME customers, who in many respects might be not that far distant from retail, and given, you know, the regulators' stronger focus now on SME and how they're served by regulation?
So I think in practice it already is, partly because of the overhang from the financial crisis and sort of GRG and you know, the Reading scandal and so on. I think the regulators will be, you know, are very sensitive to small businesses being badly treated off the back of this, and I think firms will be as well. So I think de facto there already are vulnerable small businesses and tens of thousands of them. You know, I think everyone should be treading on eggshells around collections, because if you get it wrong, I think it's serious. Well, I think it's seriously bad news all round, frankly, because I think, you know, there clearly is a broader interest in the, where possible, businesses that went into the pandemic in decent shape survive and come out of it in decent shape. You know, I think that's kind of in everyone's interest. The issue is how you get there.
Yeah, well, in the news roundup section of the webinar later, I was going to reference the FCA fine at Barclays, which is in relation to handling of arrears, consumer credit customers in arrears. Now that was for the period 2014 to 2018, £26 million fine. A failure to consider individual circumstances, classic kind of failures. So in a way, nothing particularly new or insightful to see there.
I think to the extent that banks in particular are outsourcing some of these things and creating special units and so on, that there's a real responsibility that actually they still have oversight. And to the extent that you try and automate stuff, there will always be exceptions, and it's how you deal with those exceptions. So that individual circumstance thing is really quite real.
And it's extremely hard to do, yes, and to come up with a realistic approach to handling the arrears issue. You know, realistic is might be collecting virtually nothing, actually. So, in any other time, I'm not sure I would have batted much of an eyelid on that final notice, because it's just saying things you'd expect it to say, but I guess in the current environment, I'm thinking this text might be repeating itself, you know, multiple times in the next few years. Just a quick round up some of the other things that the FCA and the PRA have done in respect to COVID, or have been influenced by COVID. I mean, not a great deal actually, but in December, so we've had a grace period for temporary vacancies at the SMF level. So, yeah. You know, the original rules say 12 weeks, and basically that was being waived. And there was the requirement to update statements of responsibility if you temporarily change responsibilities was waived as well. And basically, in December they announced that stopping. So
that was good timing.
Yeah, seven, exactly. Well, yeah. So it was the 18th of December. latest restrictions. So your statement of responsibility needs to be up to date by 10th of January. Why not?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I think if firms are still having problems with that, then I don't think the regulator can realistically say, actually, we're not going to let you do this anymore. No, we're back at third lockdown. We've got more infection now than we had when it was originally introduced. So you're more likely, I suspect, to have people off sick for periods of time than you have been. So I think it's classic. I think it's a beautiful example of regulators trying to get ahead of the curve and being agile and not, you know, and sort of getting back to normal and then just being caught.
Thanks responsibility. You need to be up to date by the 10th of January. The 12-week window for replacing an SMF is, you've got till April actually, so you've got the longer period of time, but I think it's from April onwards you need to. So I would have said about this. I mean, it's interesting given its unfortunate timing with the latest spike in cases, but it was on the face of it. Just for example, this is in some ways the new normal, or at least the expectation is that firms can operate in this new normal environment. And similar things I think were said around the guidance on financial crime and screening. So you know, you need to be able to. I think there was a Market Watch I was looking at yesterday, which just again makes clear for call recording under the MiFID rules, if you're covered by that, you know, just reinforcing the expectation that you should be able to do this.
I think that's an adjustment the other way. So I think that will stick, because you have to you're almost saying actually this is permanent, so we need to reset financial crime expectations and market abuse expectations and so on. I think there'll be something that plays out there about, you know, what does all this mean when a substantial proportion of people are working from home. You know, how does that actually, you know, how does that actually look in terms of how you regulate it, what you expect of firms, et cetera, et cetera.
But you know, the overarching message, I think, frankly, we've been saying this since last summer, and I don't think anything's really changed. Is arguing that the coronavirus or the lockdown is preventing you from managing your business in a controlled way or complying with the regulation is not viable anymore. You can't. That's not the expectation. The expectation is you will be compliant. They issued 11th of December, following their High Court win on the business interruption, they issued some guidance to insurers on how to assess business interruption claims. That's a really gory read for anyone who wants to look at it, in the sense of, if you have a business interruption policy that says you can claim if there is an outbreak of a disease within 15 miles or 25 miles, whatever the policy wording is, and it basically sets out, in line with the High Court ruling, how you might go about assessing whether COVID is in the vicinity. And it's lots of wonderful stuff, like looking at the NHS mortality statistics and the like. So my takeaway is that given the state of the virus across the country, that every business will be able to claim under that kind of policy wording, which I think is pretty much the direction of travel of that court case. But that was a really fun read before Christmas. Also before Christmas, the PRA, you referenced this earlier about the PRA's view of where sort of bank capital ratios are. They lifted or set this is a fairly toned down the ban on paying dividends.
Yes.
And
I don't know whether they've got a cap in place.
Yeah. Which I think is important. But I suppose it was an interesting sign that you do wonder then whether that cap is going to stick around for
I wouldn't be
time.
Surprised for a while. I mean, I think they'll have been very uncomfortable with the original action, and I think it will probably was driven very much by being at the start of the pandemic, and I think probably more influenced by the market volatility dash for cash than about real concern over capital levels, and because the government is basically supporting all the loans to industry, the pressure on kind of bad debt provisioning and so on is not as high as it would be otherwise. So I think it's sensible. But I think that the I think the cap, keeping the cap is, that does mean something. And I think, you know, I think it's all part of, you know, what really is the relationship between government, regulators, and the largest firms, and how has the pandemic changed that?
We had a question through on Brexit, which is going to be our next topic. But I wanted to, we're going to throw up, Jessica, then can you throw up the next poll question? So this is a totally gratuitous poll question. I apologise. But I keep seeing survey data on, you know, various groups and geographic groups and you know, subsets like medical professionals, etc. Similar questions to this. So I thought financial services professionals on the call, where you would tick on this this selection, given as we're told, you know, the vaccines are one of the roots out of this. So I guess take up of the vaccine is something people will be looking at. So I'm just curious. There is no right or wrong answer, by the way, in my mind. I can see both sides of this one. So I don't know what the results were. Hey, there we go. Okay, it's interesting. That's actually, I would say 75%, I think, is very much in line with sort of national opinion polls in this country.
Yeah.
I know a lot higher than some other countries, if you look at some of the numbers that are thrown out there, about France, for instance. But so there was me thinking financial services professionals were a breed apart, but apparently we're not. We're pretty much the same as everyone else. It's probably quite a good thing when it comes to whether or not the vaccine will work. We're much the same. Right, Brexit. Well, the deal. I guess the deal we all expected kind of happened.
Well, the non-deal. Financial services.
Yeah, for the purpose of this conversation, financial services is no deal. I mean, so there is a deal, but I think we're right to talk about financial services as a no deal. Are we not? But which was, I think, again, expected largely. What happens next then?
I think lots of talking and lots of future mini deals. I mean, they've got. There's meant to be an MOU, I think, between the Treasury and the European Commission by the 31st of March. So that's a kind of UK EU deadline. So you can make of that what you will. I think it's worth noting that the UK regulators have bilateral MOUs with almost, with all the significant EU countries, and also with the ESAs, the EBA and ESMA and so on. So there's a lot of that already in place. We got this MOU, and then the ongoing debates will be around equivalence in, a whole series of specific areas as they come up.
Yes.
And that will, that is the rest of our lives.
We're being prompted by the audience that when we talk about the deal, we should do air quotes. Thank you. I fully endorse that suggestion.
I think if I did this every time it was, it was appropriate, I would,
Every time a politician said anything, I think we probably need to be using air quotes. Yes. I mean, there have been some developments. I forget the exact number, but there were a number of, the UK issued a number of equivalence decisions in respect of the EU, primarily around trading infrastructure exchanges, etc., was essentially, allow UK entities to trade on a, for instance, on an exchange that is sitting in the EU, rather than having to just trade on recognised exchanges, which would not include ones in the EU unless it was an equivalence decision. But obviously, it's been pretty much robbed by traffic today, and there's obviously been reports we've all seen about the, a volume of trading. Yeah. In certain types of assets and certain types of clients moving to the EU, which I think is probably again expected. Is it time to reflect on equivalence and the joys of equivalence or the weaknesses of it? I think it's very clear as we all expected, it's very much a political decision rather than a. An actual.
Yeah, I was going to say I'm no expert on it, but the one thing that has come home to me over the last 2 years, I suppose, is that ultimately it's a political decision, not a technical one. So the EU can decide that the UK is equivalent or not. And actually, that what happens on the ground is sort of secondary to that. On the assumption that we're going to, you know, which is in the future regulatory framework stuff, you know, we're going to maintain highest global standards and so on. It should almost always be possible for the UK to be deemed to be, you know, realistically deemed to be equivalent with the EU and the US and any other major jurisdiction.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, the question is, what does that look like? You know, is that what happens in practice?
Yeah.
And that feels like a political debate more than anything else.
And it absolutely is. I mean, I think some of the game, that's what politicians do when it comes to negotiating is I mean, so my understanding of the position, at least formally, is that they want to understand the UK's future plans for regulation.
Yeah.
Are you going to stay the equivalent, essentially?
And to be fair, we've made, you know, parts of the government, certainly on the Brexit debate, were very much along the lines of, actually, we're going to be completely different. And, you know, we are going to be a low regulation offshore centre, you know, Singapore on Thames, we've talked about before. So there's a certain amount, it's not like the rhetoric along those lines doesn't exist.
No, although in the future of regulation consultation, the rhetoric is international standards and...
Yeah, so that's fine. And, you know, but there's still obviously space to deviate from that. I mean, there's a kind of a recognised thing, for example, that the, you know, EU legislation, at least in part because it has to tie 27 different countries, is at a very detailed level in a way that the UK would never do left to its own devices. So yeah. Even where we've been responsible for huge chunks of EU regulation, if it was just us, we would have written it differently. So it would be more flexible and you know, just at a higher level. I suspect we redo Solvency II. I suspect we'll come out with something like that. And then there's other issues about, you know, there's a review of how we list companies, which I think is interesting. And I saw a bit in the paper the other day about the EU flagging the UK as a centre for financial crime.
Oh, yeah.
Which again, I think is an interesting area where we need to be careful.
No, I agree. Well, at what point, just to throw a counterpoint on that, at what point does making even any attempts to stay equivalent become pointless because it's just not on the table? I mean, the EU's got a game to play there, because if it drives the UK's politicians to the point of saying, well, we'll just deregulate, we will pull wholesale activity out of Europe by being a lower regulation, you know, it's a bit of a tightrope on both sides. But suffice to say, yeah, you're right. I mean, we did have a poll question. Let's start the poll question. We actually had some quite good questions, which I'll reflect on in a second. But we did have a quick poll question, which kind of plays to this, where do we think we'll be on financial services trade with the EU in 1 year's time? And the three options are pretty much the same as today. Things will be getting better because there'll be some progress around equivalence recognition agreements, or trending worse. And I think that might either be because new rules are written that make actually cross-border trade even harder, or it just might be the attitudes of regulators. So, you know, the way they enforce the current rules. But basically, it's getting even harder to do business cross-border. So this is a sort of a prognosticating question. Where do we think we're going to be? A split. I mean, you know, not an overwhelming.
This one's worth asking again, isn't it? A few times over the next months.
It is. We'll still be asking in 5 years' time, Gavin. You know that. We'll just have to change the timescales. below lockdown. A couple of quick questions on around Brexit. I mean, the impact on the financial services compensation scheme. Have you got any thoughts on that? I know there's the kind of the you know, what deposits are now covered and what deposits aren't covered, kind of clarification that's been issued.
Yeah, and there's also the fee base issue that we talked about before, that potentially you're calling on fewer organizing, you've got a smaller constituency to fund compensation.
It's an interesting me, the both PRA and the FCA the last month or so have issued papers on how they supervise international firms, and it's primarily directed obviously at the UK ends of international firms, and the FCA one is a fair, pretty much a regurgitation, I would say, of the requirements. There's no real directional flavour about what's good versus bad. PRA one, which obviously aimed predominantly at banks and insurers, is more interesting because they are rather more explicit about saying, well, depending on your footprint, we're going to need to be a subsidiary. Again, certain circumstances, we might allow a branch, in others, it's a subsidiary. And actually, if your footprints are particularly significant, then we want to hold a very much an independent entity in the UK with strong protections against group influence, etc. So it's much, much more positional in terms of what they I found that interesting. Although you could say, well, if banks and insurers, they're more important. So
I think also, to be honest, it's partly the difference between prudential regulation, which is on the whole more tangible. And you know the directions in which the problems are coming, and conduct regulation, which is just a bit more amorphous, and also to be frank, the PRA probably put more thought into it. It had more resources to do this sort of thing. I know the FCA is bigger, but in terms of the analytical resource to pull in, to concentrate on this stuff, the PRA is better resource to start with, and it's got all the kind of the engine of the bank as and when it needs it. So and this applies to things like operational resilience and climate change as well. Anything that's like that, I mean, I think we'll increasingly see the PRA taking the kind of the intellectual analytical lead.
Yes. Well, yeah. So is what we're seeing from the PRA then the direction of travel that will be that they actually will come through the FCA in time, if not in this latest.
I think so.
And I'm going to have to say, just speaking personally, in terms of the clients I interact with and some of the FCA work I've been involved in, there's a much, much stronger emphasis on threshold conditions in an international setting than maybe I would have seen a few years ago. So demonstrable control in the UK, mind the matter, all those things, and the examination of how the links with group an international group are working, and whether or not that's in any way causing some of the conflict
And ultimately that's the same space as some of the Gloucester review, where you're talking about regulated and unregulated activities. I think looking at how a UK, UK branch or subsidiary of a wider group, how it operates in a group setting, it's really important to get a handle on it. But actually, it's not straightforward, and you need to actually have, people with some element of expertise putting serious time in order to get a proper grip of it. So that that's quite an interesting sort of reorientation of priority, what you've just described.
We have a question. Well, so any FCA appetite to look at firms? So we've got a few business models. I mean, it's where in order to continue to operate in the EU, they've created a EU sub. But at this point in time, most of the activities is probably being done in the UK in relation to that sub. Maybe it's a UK entity, or maybe it's even a branch in the UK at this point. And that obviously has implications for the regulator in Europe in terms of what's been done there locally. But I guess it's a question for Philly. Is the FCA going to be interested in what's going on in the UK in relation to business in the EU? There's a perimeter thing there, isn't there, really?
Yeah, I mean, I think up to a point that, I mean, there was lots of work done when the FSA was formed about what are you interested in, you know, if a product's designed in the UK and it's serviced in the UK, but it's sold in the Middle East, to give an example, what's the, you know, how interested should you be if you have the, you know, a branch in the UK, but it is a branch of an enormous bank in another country, how interested are you in the head office? There are endless angles to that, but I think in terms of the EU, that will all have to be redone, if you like, and there will be some kind of judgment about the quality of regulation in the home country.
Another quick question, which I don't know the answer to, but what is the status of the ACA, so the chartered accountants profession, being recognised in the EU? I know this stuff going on around legal. The legal version of that. I don't know. Whoever raised that question, are you intending to flee the country and go and work in the EU? Is that a question?
I don't know the answer to that one either.
No. It's a big. This is why, you know, understanding the detail of your.
I mean, I think there is doubt about mutual recognition, yeah. Professional qualification. I think there's definitely
across the board, and that could have implications for who you want to put into, you know, key roles in Europe, regulatory roles in Europe. Right, we're going to have a 2-minute news roundup. Boom, 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 boom. We had a big cyber attack at SolarWinds, which is a bit of software that apparently a lot of firms use, and a big hack, allegedly, by the Russians ensued. That happened in mid-December, and I think we'll probably be looking at the fallout from that for quite some time. But I know the headlines around that have sort of government institutions, etc. But that's going to be relevant, I think.
I think it just means cyber. You know, cyber is not going away. I mean, I think cyber is not going away. Obviously, you've got next month probably the PRA and FCA, I think it's draft policy statement in response to the big consultation on operational resilience, which obviously is all around cyber and so on. So I think that's a that's quite big. I think you've also got, I think we're president of the G7, and I think there's a cyber conference due in May.
Yes, we are president. Yes,
as well. So I think it will be one of the kind of agenda headlines for the next few months.
Presumably relevant to me because I do a lot of my work around investment firms, investment managers, and brokers. I was waiting with bated breath for the big consultation paper from the FCA on the investment firms prudential regime. So new prudential rules for 3,200 MiFID firms to come into effect on 1st of January 2022. So that CP finally landed in on the 14th of December, except when I looked at it, I discovered it's actually going to be one of three CPs. So quite a lot of juicy
that's
stuff.
That's been about 8 years in the making, I think. You know how long the timelines are.
Okay, anyone that's affected by those rules needs to read that CP. But it just if you're expecting it to be the soup to nuts on everything you need to know, then think again, because it's going to be a trilogy. We saw, and I think maybe we'll kick this just a proper discussion around this into the next webinar. But the evaluation, the FCA's evaluation of RDR, the Retail Distribution Review, and the Financial Advice Market Review, several years on that. And a report on that was issued on 3rd of December. It probably won't take long to discuss it, actually, given it says things have improved a bit, but not enough, essentially. No recommendations, but more work to be done. Call for input, I think. We had FCA fines of Charles Schwab for CAS failures. We've had Barclays. We've had IFAs for unsuitable pension transfer switching. So I'm conscious of time. We'd better wrap it up at that point. Gavin, thank you very much. For those that have enjoyed this potentially, hopefully, we'll see you for next month. There are a couple of other events on the screen at the moment, which you are very much invited to join as part of our webinar program. And with that, I will say thank you very much and have a great day, everyone.